How did the dinosaurs become extinct? Welcome to the Natural History of Dinosaurs. My name is Benjamin Berger. I'm a paleontologist at Utah State University, teaching in the heart of Utah's dinosaur country in Vernal. This is the last video lecture on the Natural History of Dinosaurs, and it's all about the extinction of the dinosaurs, the non-avian dinosaurs. So, what killed the dinosaurs 66 million years ago? There have been hundreds of explanations put forth over the years. Hypotheses have included diseases, the dinosaurs becoming over-specialized and too big, mammals out-competing the dinosaurs. There was a change in the flora, a climate change, marine regressions where the oceans retreated, and interstellar dust clouds and cosmic radiation. I've even heard of dark matter being put forth. But most of these ideas, they lack much evidence. In this video, we're going to look for evidence. Particular evidence gathered over the last 30 years for two primary causes for the extinction of the dinosaurs. The first is an asteroid impact, and the second is volcanic eruptions. Before we examine these catastrophic causes of extinction, we need to define what we mean by mass extinction and just regular old background extinction. Now, the Earth has gone through five mass extinction events, and the mass extinction at 66 million years ago is known as the KT extinction event. K for Cretaceous, and T for the older tertiary term for the Paleogene and Neogene periods. Mass extinctions are when the total extinction rate is much higher than normal. That is, natural selection, changing environments, and the survival of the fittest drive species to extinction. And that's just called background extinction. But during certain short intervals of time, extinction rates go through the roof. And it is these events that many species become extinct over a very short duration of time. So periods of high extinction rates are called mass extinction events, while low extinction rates are called background extinction. Let's look at what the Earth looked like 66 million years ago. The large interior seaway in North America had retreated, and the continents were roughly in the same places as today. India still had not reached Asia, as it drifted northward to form the Tibetan Plateau and the highest peaks we have today. India was besieged by volcanoes, which poured forth large amounts of lava that today form the basalt layers of rocks called the Deccan Traps. These lava flows date to around 65 million years ago, roughly the same time period that the dinosaurs disappeared. There has been some conjecture that these large volcanic eruptions in India during this time caused the extinction of the dinosaurs by releasing large quantities of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. Indeed, there are indications that carbon dioxide in the atmosphere was much higher near the KT event, and that climate may have been changing by getting hotter. But could these volcanoes have been responsible for the extinction of a group of animals and many other living things in the oceans to go extinct after a successful 180 million years of living on the Earth? A different hypothesis was put forth by a man named Walter Alvarez. Walter Alvarez was a petroleum geologist working in North Africa, who also had an interest in archaeology, and he loved visiting the ruins in Italy during his time off from his job searching for oil. On one trip, he met up with some Italian microinvertebrate paleontologists who showed him the KT boundary exposed in some limestone. Below the boundary, the organisms are dominated by really huge, large foraminifera. And above the boundary Only tiny foraminifera remained in the limestone. There was a thin layer of clay at the transition between the Cretaceous and Paleogene rocks. And this thin layer of clay, Walter Alvarez sampled. He thought his father might be interested in this clay. His father was Luis Alvarez, who is a Nobel-winning physicist working in California. And his father had access to all these new scientific tools for understanding the makeup of materials. Now, Luis Alvarez was working on some experiments that could analyze the clay for its mineralogy and chemical makeup. So he sent the samples off to his father. Walter's father, Luis, was working with Frank Azzaro and Helen Michael in the Berkeley lab, who are using a new fancy machine called a neutron activation analysis, which bombards a substance with neutrons to make atoms in the material radioactive. And then they can measure the spectra of emissions of the sample to identify elements in the clay. Now, this new tool could detect up to 74 elements, and most of them are rare elements like gold, silver, argon, but does include some common elements like potassium and silica. This means that the researchers could get a spectra of the concentrations of these elements, including very rare elements. Now, the researchers analyzed the clay that Walter had collected, and they found large amounts of iridium in the sample. Other samples he sent from below and above the clay layer returned more normal concentrations of iridium. So what is iridium? Iridium is a rare metal, element 77, which is very rare. Gold is 40 times more abundant, and platinum is 10 times more abundant. It's so rare that it does not make a currency because there's just not enough of it. If you were to look at the amounts of elements found in rocks on Earth's crust, you will see that iridium is near the bottom of the list, right near neodymium. The reason for this has to do with several factors, but the major one is that iridium sank into the interior of the Earth during the early formation of the planet. One of the places that you can find iridium is in rocks that never underwent this melting and depletion, and that is meteorites. Meteorites contain the original ingredients of the Earth, which includes a larger concentration of iridium. The researchers at the Berkeley lab concluded that the clay layer that Walter sent them was filled with uranium from a massive meteorite that struck the Earth 66 million years ago. Since their original paper, hundreds of additional sites around the world have demonstrated a spike in the amount of iridium at the boundary between the Mesozoic and Cenozoic. Did this meteorite impact kill the dinosaurs? The search for an impact structure revealed a crater on the tip of the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico called the Chicxulub Crater. The structure was detected using geophysical seismic surveys made by geologists looking for oil. In the cores brought up from drill rigs, geologists discovered shock quartz, grains of quartz crystals that have stressed crystalline lattice structures, which results from the compression of tremendous forces. Other sites have shown that shock quartz grains are widely distributed during this event and found in the clay layer across North America. The structure of the impact crater showed that the meteorite struck at a low angle into the Caribbean Sea. Estimates based on the mass balance of osmium in the clay layer support an asteroid about 4.1 to 4.4 kilometers in diameter, while the size of the crater supports a larger asteroid about 10 to 15 kilometers in diameter. So pretty big. Many models of what happens when the Earth is hit by an asteroid of this size have been modeled. Here we see the first 30 seconds of impact. On contact, the asteroid would push into the various layers of water and rock with such speed as to turn the rock into liquid and vaporize the ocean waters. Ejection of liquefied rock and the molten asteroid itself with intensely heated water vapor would soar up into the atmosphere. No matter where you were on the Earth, you would feel a blast of infrared radiation, which would send temperatures up to 60 degrees Celsius, feeling as if you were thrusted into a hot oven. The temperature would be hot enough to set fire to trees and any organic matter around you. Everything would be set on fire, and this fire would burn through the rich Cretaceous forests and deplete the amount of oxygen in the atmosphere, which would drop by a whole percent. Evidence of a thin layer of charcoal can be found above the iridium clay zone, supporting a massive fire and die-off of the forests during this interval. If you survive the burning landscape, the skies would be darkened for months. All those foraminifera in the oceans would lack sunlight for photosynthesis, and the larger marine life that depended on photosynthesizing plankton would starve to death during these months of darkness, and so would any surviving dinosaur without plant food. Ash and other ejecta would slowly rain out of the skies. Then, with the rain and sunshine nearly 60 days after the blast, ferns would start to grow again above the iridium clay and the charcoal. There's actually a spike of fern spores. Similar to the regrowth of the surfaces of land consumed by lava after a volcanic eruption, the worst was over. So which animals survived? Fish, sharks, amphibians, turtles, crocodiles, lizards, mammals, and birds. 5 out of 8 of these animals lived in water, so they may have been insulated from the radiation and heat, while lizards, mammals, and birds are small creatures that could have survived the months of darkness by feeding on seeds and nuts. Birds that had beaks adapted to eating seeds had survived, as did mammals that may have stored food in the form of nuts in burrows and holes. Lizards did not have to eat as frequently, and with a higher heat tolerance could have withstand the hotter temperatures. Each group was lucky if they had the right lifestyle to survive the cataclysm. But were the dinosaurs already doomed before the impact of the asteroid? Were they already bound for extinction? And what was the distance between the KT boundary, the iridium spike, and the last dinosaur? Is there any evidence that maybe dinosaurs survived for a few million years after the asteroid impact? One of the most interesting sites is a fossil locality in Montana called Bug Creek. It's a small site that contains both dinosaur bones and Paleocene mammals. Did these dinosaur bones indicate that dinosaurs survived into the Cenozoic? The puzzle was studied by Donald Lofgren. He thought of 2 possible scenarios for this co-occurrence. First, that the dinosaur bones were laid down first, and then the surface was eroded down to the exposed bones, and a second filling of sediment deposited the Paleocene mammal teeth and jaws. The KT boundary would be between those 2 periods during that period of erosion. The second scenario is that the dinosaur and mammal bones were deposited after the erosion event at the same time, and both after the KT. boundary. Hence, these dinosaur bones were from a dinosaur that survived the extinction event. Now, after careful study, it was found that the mammals and dinosaur bones did not coexist at the same moment. They were spaced apart by a few thousand years. Other sites of dinosaur bones mixed in with the Paleocene rocks have been reported, but these dinosaur bones are all reworked, fossils that eroded out of the rock to be deposited in the younger strata. No one has found a definitive Cenozoic dinosaur yet. But were the dinosaurs on their way out anyway? Some researchers have pointed out that dinosaurs near the end of the Cretaceous were less diverse than they were earlier. These graphs show how morphology was more similar among ceratopsians and hadrosaurs during the last 3 million years compared to earlier periods of the late Cretaceous, while solosaurs and pachycephalosaurs show no pattern of similarity. There were many dinosaurs near the boundary, and it's hard to justify that dinosaurs were dying out at the end. Although some of the iconic dinosaurs were larger than they had previously been, suggesting that they would have a hard time surviving the blast of a large asteroid slamming into the Earth. One thing we do know, and that is that mammals were able to survive, and for the next 66 million years would come to dominance. This dominance of mammals was due in large part to the KT event, in which mammals no longer had to contend with hungry dinosaurs, and they could become larger and more diverse than ever before. All right, be sure to explain what happened at the KT boundary and justify your explanation with evidence that has been gathered from scientific observations. Thank you so much for watching this video lecture series on dinosaurs. I really hope you enjoyed these and learned a little bit about dinosaurs along the way. Thank you very much for watching.